Welcome back to the Watch Some Series podcast. I am your host, Brandon, and we got Devin and Stephanie back with us as usual. And today we also have a special guest. We have Charmaine from the Militantly Mix podcast. And we are back to discuss the season finale of Insecure. This is episode 8 of season 3, Ghostlike. So I guess we'll start with Charmaine. What did you think about this episode overall?
I mean, I think it wrapped up better than the season felt like it was going to me. I don't know. I was starting not to really feel the show much anymore. It was kind of dipping for me a bit, but I feel like this episode kind of picked back up. Like, it's beautiful. Like, I'm a film person, so I was paying attention to how beautifully shot it always is. So they had all that going on. But I kind of like the end note. The path that we got Issa on now looks like it's not necessarily about a man, and it's about her own path. So that part I'm all right with. That part I'm excited about.
What about you, Steph?
I was loving all of the Last Dragon references. I love the remake at the end. I was like, who the heck is this? Because you know what? The music this season has been so clutch. I absolutely love it. I'm like, the episode was so good. To see Issa be a whole ass adult, I was like, mwah, that's exactly what I needed.
It takes time.
It really does.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, that's what your 30s are for, to become a goddamn adult.
I tell all these 20-somethings, like, yo, keep fucking up. You can fuck up being 20. Just do it till something sticks to the wall. Because in your 30s, you can't make those mistakes. It's like, you can't make mistakes in your 30s. Like, just do all the shit you want to do. You can make as many mistakes because you can bounce back in your 20s. When you're 30, man, you gotta think about things like rationally. Like, yo, I can't come back from this one. Like, shout out to our newest co-host.
Oh, you can hear her?
Fur baby.
Yeah, yes, we can hear her. What's her name again?
Coffee. She's playing with Darth Vader right now.
Oh my goodness. How old is she?
12 weeks.
What? Oh, she's a baby, baby.
A baby. A baby. Devin, what'd you think?
I think, because on this podcast, we was all wrong about this whole shit, because we didn't give it enough forethought that, like, yo, there's no way she can put this block party together in the time we had to wrap this show up. Mm-hmm. So we all were thrown off on that. And this being able to see a successful black event being pulled off with a lot of beautiful black people coming together was great. And definitely...
the whole show's full of beautiful black people. There's no ugly people in the show.
Yeah, you're right, though. I mean, I'm just talking about this event. The event, Brandon.
Oh, you're talking about Dro?
That's cool.
Oh, God.
You know how I feel about the Monstar.
That nigga. But then, like, I mean, I ultimately took away from it, like, yo, listen to old heads, yo. Old heads know. Like, it's real. Your parents' advice or your auntie, your uncle's advice about this whole relationship shit. I mean, some of it's fucked up, but a lot of it makes sense. And, like, it plays out in real life. And I really enjoyed it. I enjoyed all the cameos from everybody coming back from seasons past. And definitely my man, what's the nick? Andrew. Andrew let that shit down. He was like, bitches, y'all checking for me next year.
I'm checking for him now. Hey, he's about to be on the Lewis Pan track, okay?
But yeah, I enjoyed it. I think the season wrapped up really good.
All right, cool. So, all right, I'll get to my thoughts into the show. Let's get started. So the show starts off. Issa's going to restaurants and different black businesses to try to get sponsorships. for her block party. And I've done this before. And it's just like that. Like, don't nobody want to do it. So you gotta. The problem with Issa is she was making it all about her, and not about the benefits of them, right? So see, every time she was going there, she's like, "Well, I'm trying to get this, or I'm trying to get that," and instead of telling them like what they're gonna get out of it, because like I did a Taste of a City event in South Phoenix in Arizona, so I had to go to these different businesses around there and restaurants for them to come out, and basically my whole pitch was like, how this is going to make it good for you, how it's going to change the perception of this area, blah, 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 blah. And that got them to come out instead of talking about what it's going to do for us. So she was messing up there, but that's normal because she ain't never done this before. And then she asked some rapper nigga, like, to come out, and this nigga was like, how many bitches are going to be there? And she was like, one bitch.
One bitch.
That kid was everything, yo. That cackle from his boy in the back had me on the floor. I said, you know what?
Yeah, and then she even went to her own complex asking them niggas there. And then homegirl Trina, wasn't her name Trina?
Yeah, Trina.
And Trina's like, I'll be there.
Crazy ass would be there.
Hey, my man gonna bring his imaginary dog, yo. That's in his apartment.
That's a real dog.
That's a whole real dog, too.
Oh, that's who that was the dude she was talking to?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. So then that happened. So then they jumped to Molly and Issa getting coffee. And she was like, I'm about to put this block party on hold. And then she tried to make a pun. Like, that's why I blocked. She was like, Nathan, I can't believe Nathan had me doing this. And that's why he is Sandra Bullock. Like,
that shit was so good. Awkward. That shit was good, yo. I don't give a fuck.
Listen, Issa would be laughing at her own jokes, too.
That's what you gotta do.
So love it. I love that about her.
It's such a natural thing.
Like, I'm funny as shit, y'all.
Right, you know?
So then Issa told Molly that, Molly started talking about her job and shit, and Issa was like, yeah, but you ain't had to throw all that shade at Tori and this shit. And she was like, I ain't throw no shade. Like, I was just trying to do what I thought was right. And he was like, she was like, it's always this sexism in the workplace. Like, if a man is aggressive, it's like outgoing and ambitious, and if a woman's aggressive, I'm being shady and shit. And I was like, that's true, Molly, but you are kind of shady. Like, you admitted it yourself. So I'm like, I kind of feel both ways on that, because first of all, Torian is a whole chump, because he was absolutely out there talking over all the women in the office, trying to be like the star of the show, and then he and his feelings because Molly stepped out and did something on our own. However, go ahead.
You can't step on that male ego, especially in a workplace like that. Like, he can't let you have that. So, I mean, he played his role like he's supposed to for a dude with his feelings hurt. I ain't mad at him for doing that.
Yeah, his feelings was definitely hurt. So, Steph, what do you think about at this point, before we get to the later stuff, did you think Molly did the right thing by stepping up in that meeting last week?
I know. Isn't it bad for me to have to say yes or no instantly? It's like, honestly, no. It's like, no. It's like, she bringing her 53% energy to that black ass office. I'm like, girl, just burning the whole, just burn every bridge you got, girl. Just burn every bridge. I'm like, you could have. It's like, she wants like this instant, I'm the best thing. And I'm like, girl, you just got there.
Yeah, she told her therapist that she wanted to be the star always.
And I'm like, you're not in the whole all-white office anymore where it's easy for you to become the star because you're the only. You're not the only anymore. You're going to have to take a step back, girl. It's all right.
Girl. Yeah, I feel mixed on that, too. Like, I definitely think she stepped. I mean, she was straight up told, like, no, we need to do this together, and still took the opportunity in that way that a little kid goes to mommy, asks a question, goes to daddy, asks a question, and sees which one's going to give him the permission. Right. Yeah, like, that's really how she did it. But at this, like, if this was the old white law firm, I would have been like, yeah, step on that white dude's toes. Right. You know? But in this case, like, she's new, and those are her people too. Like, everybody's trying to succeed alongside of each other. I don't fault her for doing the presentation. I fault her for how she did it.
I don't know, though. It's like, it's that fuck shit Torian be on too, like, cause the way Torian be sunning her, like, be like really diminishing her, like, even though they're supposed to be collaboratory on their project, it's like, nah, I gotta make sure I check your work and shit. Like, nah, bro, like, I'm good at what I do too. Like, so I mean, it was a call.
He's definitely a micromanager. And he's the type of person that's like, he thinks his way is the right way. But at the end of the day, like, Molly's new there. Like, this has been the whole thing for me from the start. She rolled up in that place like she's been there for years. And I'm like, you're in a new law firm. Like, you can work your way up, but you got to work your way up. You don't just be up.
And but she did say, like, boom, I'm taking on this responsibility. Like, she's volunteering herself. So, I mean, she is putting herself gonna like into that.
And here's the thing. And I wrote down later that ambition is a bitch because, like, ambition will get you both ways because part of ambition is going out there and doing those types of things. But you got to balance that with not trying to, like, show up to people that you're working with. Because now she's, well, we'll get to it later, but now she's stuck working on that big-ass project all by herself with no help because Torian was being petty and because she was being Molly. Then Issa was like, y'all niggas should break bread. And then she was like, yeah, I'll try that. And she's like, I'll just do what a man does and tell him that he's pretty.
That shit was hilarious. That shit was good.
And so then Issa was like, yeah, last year my birthday was fucked up because Lawrence didn't remember that shit. And she wanted to be drama free. And this year, so she was like, we got a birthday surprise for you. You're going to be excited. And then Issa was like, oh, you taking me to Mexico to get real Mexican food? And Molly was like, nah, I'm not your girl.
Bitch, we're not dating.
So then you meet Lawrence and his dad. And I'm like, Lawrence's dad, this nigga from the Blacklist?
Yeah.
And I was like, no wonder his dad worked for the fucking FBI and shit. All that shit tied together. To me, all TV shows in the same world. They're all in the same
world. Oh, man, especially the black ones.
And so I love that black man, too. He got, like, the best black man, old black man voice.
He really does.
He does have a good voice.
And he asked Lawrence, like, what's been going on? Like, how's Issa? Y'all still trying to work things out? And he was like, nah, we done.
We done.
And he was like, every woman I went out with was demanding this shit. I was like, all right, here we go. This is why people don't fuck with Lawrence. And then she was like, why can't I just find a woman and get happy like you and mom? Uh-huh. And she was like, you think Sylvia easy? She was like, yeah, but you know, everybody I've been talking to be having this baggage and shit. And I was like, and he was like, man, we both had baggage, but we met together and we put in the work.
Mm-hmm. He said we both brought luggage to this and we had to work and we did the work.
And he was like, you youngins don't want to put in the work. Charmaine, do you think this is some good advice from Lawrence's dad for his whole situation?
Yeah, I mean, I have a wedding marriage situation that's a little complicated for people that aren't in my same situation, I guess. We're polyamorous, so we have to, similar to Dro, except for I still can't figure out if they're on the up and up.
Everything
for our case is open. You got to tell each other up front everything. We know each other's partners if we have other partners, things like that. But it is about work. It's constant communication. You can't just expect that you're going to get this nice package person. And infatuation is a bitch. Like, you trick yourself early on into thinking it's going to be all perfect. And then once the real stuff starts happening, you're like, oh shit, this takes some time. This takes some work and it may not work out. And, you know, we've had that with other partners that we've had before. You know, my husband and I've been together 18 years. But when we've had other partners come in, you know, we go all in, we get all excited, we get the infatuation, it gets crazy. We at one point we nested with somebody too quickly. And as soon as things got real, it ended. And that's because people weren't willing to put the work in on all sides. Like, you know, everybody had a fault in it, but ultimately it's that work. I think the dad was on point. And just like Lawrence, grow the fuck up.
Yes.
You know? Like, to think that you could just walk in, especially after you just had the montage of chlamydia. Like, you're gonna sit there and be like, I want women to come with me, no baggage. Like, really? That's where we're going? No baggage?
Yeah, I know, right? The nervous nigga.
I mean, I know you can take a shot and get over it, but you got baggage.
That's definitely baggage.
So, definitely to get off on a side note, I am of the firm belief that Dro is lying his ass off and she don't know shit. Or they do have an open relationship, but she don't know that he was fucking with Molly. One of those two. Do you think that was true?
The one that threw me off, the reason why I'm not clear on it is, what was the episode? I think it was from last season towards the end where Candace and her were side by side at the bar and he like left them for a second and they gave each other the side eye, even though they're supposed to be friends. That made me feel like, oh, we're going to get a different side of this. And as a poly person, I fucking hate poly representation on TV because they always get it wrong.
Wrong.
Like,
yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Because yeah. If Candace's reaction then was, I'm suspicious of Molly because I don't know what's going on, and Dro and her have had this childhood friendship and she might be close in a way that I'm not comfortable with, then that's a different problem than a poly problem. You know, that's a jealousy problem. If it's, but then there's times when he's on the phone with her and he's like, yeah, I'm still at, you know, Molly's. I'm still at Molly's and stuff like that. So it seems... What it seems to me is that they had a list of people that were not, like, you're not supposed to go on to these people, and maybe Molly was on that list, and so there's tension in the marriage because of it.
Yeah,
but
then at Tiffany's baby shower, she shows up, and she was, like, perfectly happy and hunky-dory with them.
And she's having a baby.
If that is because it ended, though. So that's actually the episode I only watched part of, so I didn't get to see the end of that, and I wasn't sure if Candace was going to pop up. I don't know. That one's a weird one. I can't tell if they're doing it on the up and up.
We got to wait till next season. That's the best. That's the worst part about it.
Yeah. I mean, I like the idea of talking about that dynamic just because it's something that I have personally, but I just wish the closest that came almost to it was Shameless had a triad situation for a period of time, and it was very similar to a situation that my husband and I had a little bit before that time. The way it broke up made entire sense to me too, so I liked the way they did it, but I've yet to see another show pull it off in a way that is balanced and makes sense. And you know, sometimes when you break up, it's not poly problems, it's just regular ass stupid problems.
Yep. Well, that was some good insight. So Molly show up at work and she like, where Torian? Because she's going to try to make amends. And her assistant was like, oh, Torian in the meeting with the partners and they looking for you too.
Hey,
so
you.
They right over there. So she go in the meeting and they was like, we was very impressed by Molly stepping up when Torian couldn't make it. So we want to give y'all this big ass case and want y'all to work on it together. And this nigga Torian going to go, it's good to have a teammate that's as aggressive as Molly.
Right, yeah, that shit was in the way, yo.
Like, I don't know, man. I don't really fuck with Torian like that. So, Molly be messing up, like, later in the episode, it even gets more clear. But I can't, Torian is not a sympathetic figure for me. So, it's hard for me to be like, she fucking up, even though I know she is. Because that nigga just seemed mad trash to me. So then Issa was on the interview with the beat crew and Eli, and she was like, I left my last job. He was like, why you leave your last job? And she was like, I left because I didn't have the passion for it and I wanted to do something that was more in line with my passion. And he was like, oh, all right, well, I don't know what the budget is, but I'm gonna send this up. So Steph, did you think he was like blowing her off, or did you think he was like, I want to hire her, but I really legit don't know what our budget looks like?
I think her not giving him an actual, like, solid reason for her not, her last job, probably gave him pause.
All she had to do was say it was racist.
I feel like she could have been honest. That... But still, though, when she was like, well, I just wanted something different, you'd be like, what? Are you just going to walk off this job? Like, I don't, but also, I don't know what answer she could have gave him either.
What'd you say, Sherman?
I was just like agreeing, like I used to be HR manager, and as the hiring side of it, you always looked at stuff like that suspicion. But something happened to me last year that I'm not allowed to talk about, and I'm in that exact same boat, because now when I go to interview, I can't talk about it. And so I am 14 months into unemployment because of that exact reason. I can't talk about it. And so I look shady. And if I could talk about it, it would be obvious I'm not shady.
Right.
So, like in her case, I get it. Like, you don't want to go into a hiring situation and be like, hey, my last place is racist, because that's already going to set the hiring manager on edge and say, okay, this person is going to be open to searching for problems, when it could just be like legit, this place is racist and I want to find a place that I don't have to deal with that. Like, you know, and if you can't give enough context, you cannot give enough context for someone to be comfortable with what you're saying, and you don't want to go in and trash your last employer,
right?
No matter how bad you want to, it looks bad. So
I would have just said, when I met you at the career fair, I definitely had some search for pause in myself, and I realized that the work I was doing wasn't my passion.
Yeah, but she should have said something then, because he asked her, was you looking for a job? And she said no. She's like, no, I got a place.
But again, like, you, until you know, like, it didn't really set in for her until, you know, weeks later, and then she's like, damn, like, she knew, but like, being honest with yourself is two different things. You knowing some shit and feeling it and acting on it is two different things. You know what I mean?
But I think even with her being unhappy with the job, she could have gave some sort of indication when he said, oh, are you looking for a job? She could have been like, I don't know. She could have not just said, oh, I already have a job.
Because to him, it's
that sends the message of, wait a minute, I saw you a few weeks ago.
Yeah, exactly.
Now you don't have one. It's like, okay, what
I saw you 3 weeks ago. You was cool. Now you looking for a job and shit.
So it was like,
So I'm not sure if Eli is interested in that. So that's a good cliffhanger for next season.
Glad she got Lyft, because at least she's got a job.
But, I mean, and then she meets somebody else that, you know, that could probably, you know, position her in a place for her passion, which is helping the community and doing something for the community. And we'll talk about that, like, when
you get
Lawrence's
to Lawrence's new boo.
Damn it, Stephanie. Yo, Stephanie. That's it.
Stephanie. Ooh, spicy.
It was good. Oh, my God. How good was that, though? So, that was the best. That's the best in the whole goddamn episode.
That was good. We'll get to that, too. So then Molly shows up at Issa's crib for her birthday. And look who the fuck rolls up. Fucking Nathan. I know Stephanie was so happy to see Nathan in all his light-skinned glory.
See, I say one thing about his pretty ass, and he's never gonna let me let it go.
Steph was yelling at the screen. Why is Molly sending him away?
But here's the thing: I didn't see him at first. All I heard her say was "What the fuck?" and I was like, "What?" Like,
no, I see somebody over there, but like, I wouldn't know it was
moving. I just thought it was people walking in the background, because I was like, "Why'd she say what the fuck?" Oh my God, it's Nathan.
So, Devin, what did you think when Nathan rolled up?
I was thinking that hopefully Molly wouldn't be on no fuck shit, but I realized Molly did what she supposed to do, I guess. But again, she fucked up by not saying anything. Like, girls, you knew Nathan was coming over here? Like, at least, I don't even know. This is one of them things that's hard, because, you know, you've seen your friend suffer. So, again, you don't want to cause her no more pain, especially because she really had us do a drive-by. We literally rolled up on this nigga's crib, and she became Harriet the Spy. Like,
and it is her birthday.
Right.
You know what I mean? That's a good question. Like, for Steph and Charmaine, do you think Molly did the right thing as a friend or the wrong thing?
I'm making the same face. Like, I'm the wrong woman to answer this question, because I'm like, I don't, most of my friends are dudes and all like boys I hung out with from high school. And then I have like a couple of really long-term, you know, female relationships that are tight like that. And I want to say I would do a version of what Molly did. See, Molly makes me mad. Here's the thing about Molly. Molly makes me mad because she does shit that makes you not want to support her. And then she does shit that makes you do want to support her. Yes. And she's just like, Why do you make me choose all the time? Like, I don't know. I feel like right going into her birthday, yeah, like, let Issa have a good day. And then I feel like telling her at the end of the day was fine, too. But maybe how she told her. Like, look, I didn't want to ruin your birthday, but da-da-da-da-da happened. Right. And instead being like, I saved you today, and you don't even know yet. And let me tell you how I saved you.
Exactly. Exactly.
And, oh, man.
God, like, that shit was so problematic. I was like, God,
okay.
So, but what about taking a flower? I was like, you should have took the flowers at least. So
no, because then that tells her what just happened.
Nope.
It's all or nothing.
So let me just say this. As somebody who... I'm Charmaine, you'll know this, but I identify with Molly so much, and that gets on my nerves sometimes, because I'm like, I wouldn't do it like that, Molly. Because the work stuff, I'm like, yeah, I definitely wouldn't do that. When it comes to being protective of your friends, especially when he do some fuck shit like that, and then my friend acts literally all crazy.
Right.
And you can't control it. It's like, no, you can't just... My thing is, I'm sorry, he'd have got cussed out so quick,
right?
And I would have went up there with him, and I sat there like, say what you got to say.
Okay, but, I like that.
But say
that
what you got to say. You know, but Issa sorry, is a wreck with men. You know, Molly's like,
yeah, that'll ruin her birthday.
I feel Molly did okay. I just think that it was the way she told her at the end that could have had a little bit. A gentleman.
I think she did a better job with that. She
didn't want to get her in trouble.
I didn't want to ruin your birthday, but I will. Or better yet, she should have took the flowers and hit them and gave them to her and said, "These are from Nathan, and I didn't want your birthday to be ruined." Right. But I think Issa still would have been mad because it still wasn't allowing Issa to choose for herself.
Right, because she needed that clothes. She needed to see that nigga.
She needed to, but I'm sorry.
Yeah, not
Molly needed to get in his face.
She
like,
cheated on her birthday. That's my thing. Like, nigga, come back tomorrow.
Right. Like, you can't do this tomorrow. Her birthday is today. You can't. Can you come back tomorrow? But I'm sorry. He would have got clean cussed out by me. I'm like,
he would have.
What the fuck are you doing? Why are you here?
I'm with you on Molly. I
but you know what?
A lot too.
I think Nathan is battling depression or a mental health issue.
Are we going to get to that?
Oh, yeah, we'll get to that. You're jumping ahead.
Sure.
Yeah.
All right. So then he sent Nathan the ass packing, and Molly was like, first of all, I was like, Molly's been showing the thighs all episode. Like, she was just out there.
Go ahead, juicy thigh meat. Go ahead, girl.
She was just out there all episode. I said, okay.
Yes,
okay,
girl. Molly.
So then they go to the cemetery. I'm like, what the fuck they doing at this damn cemetery? And Issa,
that's an LA thing.
That's an LA thing?
Yeah, so we do movies in this, the Hollywood Cemetery is where all the famous people get buried. And every summer they got these weekly movies and it's a big event, but it's usually a big white event. So I liked seeing the, I'm from this area. So everything that they show, when they show something, I'm like, that's my neighborhood, that's my area, like da da da. This is on the other side of town. This is in Hollywood. But to see if I had known that there was an event like that, I would have crossed town to go to that. So that's an LA thing.
See, Devin, she out there where we need to be.
I don't know if I can make it. I feel like LA's gonna burn up and fall off and be his own continent pretty soon. But other than that, you know what I mean? I'm down with it. I love LA, yo.
Yeah, so she surprised her and they going to see this last dragon viewing. I was like, that is some black ass shit. And Molly was like, you see, my instincts be right all the time. Like, I'm right at work. I'm be right about this. Like, I'd be right all the fucking time. And I'm like, that sounds like some foreshadowing to me. That's what I said. And so she was like, I'm going to be on the partner track so I can take you to Morocco. And then Issa was like, oh, you are my girlfriend.
You're my girlfriend. That shows everything. Hey,
I mean, I'm sorry.
And she was like,
I joke about that with my best friend, too. I'm like, this is my wife. I'm like, because, I mean, my best friend, we've been best friends since I was 15. So she's my longest relationship. I joke all the time. And it was like, you know, I'm like, you're basically my wife. And she's like, yeah, pretty much.
Yeah. Hetero life mate.
Yeah, ain't pretty much. Wrong with that. She is my person. And I'm
This is, again, another reason why poly presentation in the media bothers me, because poly is about multiple love, not necessarily sex. And so you could have different versions of this. So I have a male best friend that is my, he's like next to my husband, he would be my other person. And we have what I refer to as a romantic friendship. We don't have sex and all this other kind of stuff. We're not dating, but we love each other. We're affectionate. Sometimes we cuddle. Sometimes we do kiss on the face because, you know, we've known each other since we were 15, you know, the mouth or like we kiss on the lips or whatever, but not like making out. So I like to distinguish it as not, but it's what I consider a romantic friendship because it's that intimate. It's that level of intimacy that I only have usually with partners, but I have this with him and he's not a partner, you know? So that's another version of it. Like my female best friend, the same type of thing. Her dad used to call us, what did he used to call us? Life partners. Yeah, he would call us life partners. But then he would also make sure that I understood that, like, you know, Arabic people don't have gay people. So, you know, life partners, but not life partners.
We are. I am for the best.
That's funny.
Charmaine has brought, like, a whole new element to our show, and I appreciate you, Charmaine. We appreciate you.
So
she is pretty dope. That's 2 weeks in a row. You're welcome, Devin.
I'm telling you, yes, for this poly talk, I'm thinking about the life.
Well, last week it was Lauren. Lauren talking about that.
I can talk about it if you need help.
Oh,
see, now I got my life.
You should have said that because he asked too many fucking questions.
That'd be great. So, yeah, future show. I'll see you both on Mocha Minutes.
Yeah, I love talking about it. I'm not here trying to convert people. I'm here trying to explain it to people.
Definitely.
So that people
and that's helpful,
you know.
Though. That really is helpful because I think that's the problem with how, like, false shit gets spread. Because nobody, like, one, either does a Googles or listens to anybody when they talk.
Right. And if a motherfucker calls me a sister wife one more goddamn time.
Yeah.
Like, oh, man. Oh, God.
What? Wait, because so old question. Sidebar. What did you think of that show?
The Sister Wives?
Yeah.
I mean, I will admit guiltily I had tuned in a couple times just to see it. But see, that's some bullshit because that's about one man having all these wives without the wives being able to participate in that same thing. And then when one did kind of fall for someone, I guess she got catfished. But when she did fall for somebody, they strung her up. And it's like, no, this is not... This is not equity and love.
That's some fucked up shit to put on TV.
Someone else, but also to refer to it as sister wives, like there's an incestual thing going on.
Yeah, that's
I got all kind of problems with that kind of stuff. But yeah. I mean, I'm about the multi-partner life, and whether or not that's love or sex and love, or even if you know you've got one that is a friend with benefit or whatever. Like as long as there's a love element to it, whether it's platonic or otherwise, that's what I'm about. So I like to talk about it because I want to break that up, because as soon as someone hears my husband and I are poly, then they congratulate him because that they fantasize that it means a whole bunch of women.
I
heard that.
You know, he's over here like, well, what about them? They got two partners too. And they're like, yeah, but one of them's a dude. So who cares about that? You know, but like, I mean, I got a lot of the check boxes, multiracial, LGBT, poly, atheist, like I got all these check boxes. And so I just feel like with the lack of representation that I have in all of my groups, I'm willing to talk about it to
anybody. We need
to
make you famous. Goddamn. We need you out here.
But yeah, I'll talk about it online or offline, whatever. I'm here to help. I'll be a resource.
Thank you.
Look at that. So then Lawrence shows up, and her and Molly start quoting the movie and shit like some nerds. And Molly was like, y'all niggas some nerds. And he was like, yup. And then he was like, I got to get out of here, though. I'm about to go hang out with Chad. And I was like, I can't imagine what type of fuck shit Chad's up to. And I was right. So
you all right. I mean,
nigga, I will get to it. So then Kelly spotted them. And she saved a spot for them and shit. And Molly was like, why you got this big ass spot? It's just three of us. And she was like, I'm not trying to have no repeat of Coachella. So I need all the space I can so I don't fuck a white bitch up. And I was like, here we go. And then she was like, she said, somebody said some shit about Tiffany. And then Molly was like, oh no, they good now. They she made Kelly the godmother. And then Kelly was like, yeah, that means when she died, I got to take care of this damn kid. And then Issa was like, ain't that what Derek's for? She was like, good, because if I won the kid, I would have kept the last one. I said, hold up.
I was like,
I swear.
That was good.
So funny.
She always ad-libbing stuff. I'm like, you know what? She is hilarious.
That was obviously an ad-lib, because their face is like, hold on, what? I was like, y'all just going to throw the abortion in there like that?
It was so good. It was so good, though.
She's the one you want to hang out with the most.
Yes, absolutely. I was like, I need Kelly to get her own spinoff show, like, immediately. Yeah. This is too good. And
man, what's his name, Quantrez?
Fuck you, Quantrell. Wait, what?
Hold up. Hey, this nigga was like, that ain't even, who the fuck you talking to? Like,
and then she said, now we have to get back together.
Like, wait. He said, that's a nigga that look like Quantrell. Oh, that's a nigga that look like him. And then walked over and came back and it was him.
Yeah. But before
and
that,
now they're stuck,
like,
back together.
Before that, she was like, what happened to that little nigga you was fucking? And she was like, oh, that nigga, I had to get rid of him. Did she say because he wouldn't go down on me? Is that what
she
said?
Yeah, he was on that DJ Khaled shit. He was on that DJ Khaled shit.
Right.
And then, Quantrell?
No, the little nigga. One. Julius, I think his name
is
Julius.
Nathan and Andrew's friend.
Yeah.
Oh, well, he done. That nigga
the
done.
The one whose name she didn't even know the whole, all the time. Which one? Which
the
one
black one or the ace
one?
The
ace one.
Oh, I've been fucking here for a while. But look, apparently she fucked him multiple times and his body was like, oh, he gonna eat the box this time. And he never got around to eating the box, so she cut him off.
So then she was like, I done fucked three niggas in this graveyard. And that's when she saw Quantrell. And she was like, fuck you, loud as shit. I know Issa and Molly are ratchet, but I know they be mad. They be embarrassed as shit being around Kelly sometimes. They faces be looking... So,
Kelly too honest, yo.
Kelly don't have no filter. So then they go over to Lawrence and his crew, and they have Fast Mike and Chad. And this nigga Chad sitting there, little, yo, he's so little. That nigga little as shit. And he was like, and then Lawrence is like, the fuck you got a purse for? And he's like, this is my Beyonce purse. It's expensive as fuck because I bought it. And I know. And then they start talking this shit, and they basically was like, Leah forgave me. And Lawrence was like, nigga, what? How did she forgive your cheating ass? And he was like, I did a thing. She forgave me for that thing. That's it. I said, what's wrong? I was like, I need to meet Leah because she just made the worst decision of her life. This nigga Chad is trash.
She just took him back. That's all.
Yeah.
Chad is trash. He going to fuck up again. He ain't learned shit.
It don't matter. They got that old relationship where, like, a man can be an ain't shit nigga, but long as he providing and shit, we good. I hate to say it. That's just what it is.
If we ever met Leah, that may be true. I'd like to meet her, though, to see.
Oh, yeah. She hasn't popped up once, has she?
No. Nah.
But she was, apparently she was there, though, because she let that nigga out of sight. Because that's Leah's purse. That wasn't Chad's.
Yeah,
that
he said she was in the bathroom or something and didn't want to take it in, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
She's just one of those ghost characters that is always present, but you don't ever see her.
Yeah.
And then he was like, I've been watching Project Runway. I can do an A-line skirt.
Yo, that shit was funny as a bitch.
That was pretty funny.
And then you got to realize, like, that's how the nigga had to beg, he had to plead. He had to be a whole good nigga for a little bit before he can get back out here and act the whole dog in the street.
And then he said, well, it don't matter because that hair's still amazing. I'm like, this nigga. It's so
don't y'all say nothing.
This nigga, man, Chad is the fun. He's funniest. Him and Kelly, man, are funny as shit to me. They are so funny every time they come on the screen.
It would be a nightmare if they got together.
Yeah, that would be so funny.
That would be good.
So
I'd be like, two could play this game. Like,
so Blair, that was Blair, right? That was her name. That's Blair. That was Tiffany's friend. From the
I don't know, nigga. You got me thinking about the flex of life right now.
I forget
Blair.
Her name.
No, her name's Blair. Yeah, that's Tiffany's friend from the baby shower, from the Get Ready crew, whatever the fuck.
Lawrence New Boo.
Crazy crew.
Mm-hmm. So her shit's called We Gotta Have It, and she was like, I wanted to highlight some black films and shit. And I was like, this is a good idea, except I'm not fucking with no cemetery.
So, that actually is the part that seems unrealistic, just like, because as a culture, we don't fuck around with the spooky places.
Yeah.
So then he was like, She was. Then they cut to Molly, and she in line, and she see Gerard, and I was like, "Look at this nigga! I ain't seen him in a minute." And she, he looked all happy, and Molly looked happy to see him and shit. And she, he was like, "Are you a judge yet?" And Molly said some awkward ass shit like, "Order in the court." Like, that's so awkward.
She immediately was embarrassed. Yeah, immediately was embarrassed for coming out her mouth like that. Like, she shook her head like, "That was wrong. I fucked up."
Also, it's so telling about her personality that that's where she would go for to, yeah, like, that was her judge thing to be, like, controlling the proceedings.
Yeah. And so then he was like, well, I'm a, what did he say? I was a district manager.
Regional manager.
I'm like, he probably making some money. Regional manager at Enterprise, that's probably some decent money.
That's good money. You talking about? Money. Yeah, definitely.
And Molly was trying to shame that nigga when he was just working at Enterprise. Time. Right. And she was looking all happy and shit. And then this big nigga roll up and was like, can you make sure you get my drink and shit? And Molly was like, oh, this nigga gay. I got to get out of here.
I knew the nigga was gay.
And she was like, I got to get back. So, Steph, did you think that was his partner at the time?
No.
Not at all.
Not at all. I'm like, girl. And that's what happens. See, this is what happens when you find out, like, a guy that you're dating is a little bit fluid and he may or may not have...
What is he using them terms, girl? I think.
And I'm sitting here like, did you listen when he said it? Like, because I'm like, you acted like he said I had a full-blown relationship with another guy.
And I just need it all the time.
And he is bi. And I'm like, that's not what he said. First of all, I was looking at a guy like, mind you, Lawrence and Chad and that other nigga is literally, they sharing a blanket too. Like, I'm very confused why you would actually think that, why wouldn't he say that was his dude? Because he had no problem introducing you to his girl.
Right.
I'm like, y'all need to get your head out your ass. I'm like, oh, girl.
But again, to run away from the situation like that, though, like, what?
Oh, no, I knew it, he's gay.
Why? And feel justified, yeah.
It's like, girl. I feel like you missing a whole bunch of steps.
And bitch, they still ain't getting no goddamn snacks. So I'm like, bitch, you failed the mission.
Like, everything about that was bad, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I think it's important to have a moment like that to showcase, like, in terms of the culture and talking, like, very general and being on the LGBT spectrum myself. Like, we got a lot of visibility issues. We got a lot of... disregarding of our sexuality, especially as a bisexual, you know, you're just like, oh, you just haven't met the right fill in the blank yet, you know? Mm-hmm. And to sit there and to not allow him to be a full sexual person. And maybe even if that was his boyfriend, who the fuck cares? He could be bisexual and be happy with a man or happy with a woman. You don't have to fear necessarily that you're going to get dumped for those reasons. That's why being bisexual and poly works out well. But like that, like, I hate seeing that personality, that thing that just said that wants to shut down a person. Like, you know, what's his name in the show? Is Kermit in real life, right? Langston Kermit. But what's his name in the show?
Jared,
whatever.
Jared.
Yeah, like, let him be his whole damn self. Who gives a fuck? And don't feel better about yourself if you made the right decision.
Right?
Like, come on. Because what is her line? She says something like, I was out here. Like, she's something like, I was out here thinking I missed out on him, but here it is the whole time he missed out on me. Or something like that.
I was up here being sad thinking I missed out on him, but he over there happy with his boyfriend. Something like that.
Right, okay, yeah. So, again, it's...
Girl, how he look? Yay. I was like, yo.
What? I'm like, first of all, that dude was fine. And second of all, like, you hating, stop being salty. Because he ain't, like, pining for your ass.
That was such a real line, though. Like, that whole conversation was mad real to me. Like, I can totally see that playing out exactly how it happened on the show. Yeah. But I knew the show was fucking with us because I was like, the show was always showing Molly and her insecurities. So they're fucking with you. And so then she was like, but my instincts be right. I told you, Issa. And so then Kelly came back and was like, that nigga was Quantrell. Now we back together. Fuck.
She's so funny.
And then Lawrence showed up giving Issa candy. And I was like, look at this nigga, Lawrence.
And they got us again with that shit, too. Because, like, even though, like, Lawrence ain't done, but in your mind, you see Issa is going like, this idea. Lawrence is like Lawrence, and we back to being friends. And that's how they fell in love, by being friends like that. You know what I mean? So like, you can see Issa feeling Lawrence and having like some thoughts about maybe we can work it back out. And then we got it. Yeah, we got the okie doke. I mean, I did.
I feel like Lawrence and Issa is supposed to be like,
to be friends.
Well, I want them to be friends, but no, I was going to say, well, I haven't watched this show in a long time, so I don't know what the fuck happened now. But when I was watching Empire, I feel like the whole show was supposed to want Cookie and Lucius to get back together, and I feel like the whole show is supposed to make you want Lawrence and Issa to get back together, but I feel like they're much better as friends.
Yeah. I'm definitely team friends on that for them.
And so they start talking, and everybody's talking about how big Lawrence's head is and shit, and he in the way.
No, that nigga was real mad because he wasn't a nigga's way.
Nigga was like, you ain't a fucking window, nigga. And then Lawrence was asked Issa about the event. She was like, I had to put the event on hold. And, you know, the rejection was just, it was just making, I just need to make sure I'm making the right choices. And then they pan over to Lawrence. It's like he thinking about the right choices and shit. Like he thinking about Issa. And then that's when I noticed how fucking fly Issa's hair was.
That shit was super fly, yo.
Yeah.
And I was like, that shit is fly. I like that shit a lot. So then,
I don't know how you ain't been paying attention to it when she had the blindfold on. That's when it was like highlighted, yo. When she had that blindfold on, that shit was, I was like, oh, goddess. I'm worshiping it at that temple all the time.
So then the movie was over and everybody's packing up and shit, and Jared shows up and was like, I just want to introduce you to my friends. This is my brother and his girlfriend. And this is my girlfriend. And I was like,
Molly was
fucking Molly face, looking salty as shit. And Kelly gave her that. I'm surprised Kelly ain't say shit. Like, I just knew she was going to say some shit. But she didn't say no shit.
Was Kelly wasn't there, though?
No, Kelly was there. Kelly was
when
there.
When she said, not when she was like, what does that nigga look? Looking gay?
Oh, no.
That
not was
no, yeah, that's what I'm saying. She was saying some shit.
So then Issa walked up on Blair and was like, hey, I don't know if you remember me, but we met at Tiffany's baby shower. And she was like, oh, yeah, yeah. She was like, I'm trying to do some shit like you just did, but I want to do it in Inglewood and blah, blah, blah. And the girl, and Blair was like, oh, that's a good idea. So then they was back at Issa's crib, and she was telling Molly she wanted to give the block party another chance. And then Molly was saying some shit. And so I got this clip, so I'm going to play the clip.
Okay. What niggas you controlling? That nigga Nathan? Girl, he showed up at your house with some whack ass flowers like nothing ever happened. I was so mad for you.
Wait, what? Nathan came to my house.
Yeah, like right before I picked you up. And I sent his ass on the way with the quickness. I wasn't about to let him ruin your birthday, girl.
I'm sorry. Why didn't you just tell me?
You said you didn't want no drama on your 30th. So you're welcome.
Girl, what the fuck? Why? You should have just told me and let me handle it myself.
Oh, like how you handled going over his house? Bitch, you had me looking dumb while you was over there playing Harriet the Spy.
Look, I know you were trying to help, but bitch, I'm not you. I don't cancel niggas left and right.
Oh, well, when a bitch is right, a bitch is right.
I'm sorry, what? You've been on some real negative shit lately, bitch. Like, you keep assuming the worst in everybody. Like, homie from your job, for example. You just came for him out of nowhere.
Girl, it was not out of nowhere. I don't want to be like every other woman in my office, stalled out at associate. So, yeah, this is just how I have to be.
Is it?
Do you?
What's your end goal? You gonna be partner all alone with everybody hating you? Because that's not you. That's never been you.
Yeah, that was real.
So, Steph, Charmaine, whose side were you on? Or did you see both sides?
I mean, I feel like I see both sides. I 100% feel almost everything Issa said. It all made sense. But again, just going with the idea that Molly's heart was in the right place. It's just the way she...
Poorly executed.
You know, like even blocking Nathan doesn't bother me because it's leading into her birthday and she wants her friend to have a good time. The mm-hmm. the only part of that whole thing that bothers me is to congratulate herself for doing good while telling her what she did. Like, you know what? It could have just been like, hey, I didn't want to ruin your birthday. So this is the thing that I did. Nathan was here. I told him to go fuck off, but he mm-hmm. can come back tomorrow, blah, blah, blah. You know, like that would have been fine. But, you know, Issa was right. She's been super negative. She is thinking because she's got her head in that I'm always going to be the star or I'm always right. She doesn't often see her mistakes. She has a really hard time seeing her mistakes.
Not even that, though, but even when she bitching about the black firm, like she's been super negative like this whole time, like, we don't have Adobe and shit like that. Like, that's crazy. Like,
but when it comes to Issa, this season, honestly, Molly has been right about everything about Issa. So she's so used to being right in that department.
Right.
She didn't think it was a problem with her saying, see, I did something else good. I'm like, because up until this whole season, she's been totally right about the advice that she's given Issa.
But you don't got a touchdown dance. You don't got a touchdown dance.
She doesn't, but the thing about it is, like, if your completion percentage has been this high the whole damn season, it's like, I'm a touchdown dance on it.
However, be humble, man.
Yeah, y'all see how I put up that sport analogy? You know, I know about the sporty sports.
Like, see, here's the thing,
QBR
though.
My QBR has been, like, really high the whole season. But she was totally wrong the way she did it.
But here's the thing. Issa was right about most of the stuff, but this is where I thought Issa was wrong. Issa started talking about, I don't just cancel niggas like you do. And I'm like, Issa, Nathan canceled you. What are you talking about? Like,
but she don't cancel niggas though. What niggas she done canceled?
But my point is, you ain't get a chance. But she didn't get a chance to cancel. First of all, she's lying because she was just talking about earlier in the episode how Nathan's ass is blocked and she deleted that nigga from Instagram.
That was her choice though.
And blah blah
Molly
blah.
Took that choice from her.
Yeah.
Did she?
That was by her.
She did. She took the choice.
If I told Devin, like, I'm done with this girl. I don't ever want to see this girl ever again. I don't ever want to hear her name. I don't ever want to talk to her. She's out of my life. And then the girl show up, and then Devin was like, Brandon don't want to deal with her, so I'm going to tell her to leave. How can I get mad at Devin for saying that?
But you already know me. I'm like, yeah, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to get Brandon. I'm going to go get Brandon. I'm going to be right back. Because I never know. Like, you never know, because people get weak. Like, yo, people backslide all the time. But it and they don't tell nobody. And then they got you looking like Boo Boo the Fool. Like, I won't be. I'm like, y'all two adults. Y'all can handle that shit. Ain't got nothing to do with me.
But she also wanted to show that she was strong. Because for, like, the whole season, Molly was feeling like she was weak. Here was, she was living on Daniel's couch. She didn't have a place to stay.
Issa, Molly.
I'm sorry. Okay. I meant to say Issa. So here was, Issa staying on Daniel's couch. Kelly telling her she can't afford to live on her own. Then she up and quit her job. It's like then Nathan ghosted her. It's like, it's a lot of, damn, I don't have my shit together. And she feels like Molly is the only person she can really be that honest with. She's like, that's why I really identify with Issa the episode before, when she was like, I don't know if I'm ever going to find somebody who's going to make me feel that way again.
Right.
It's like, that's real. Because sometimes, like, when you let somebody in and you're so used to, like, having a wall up, and you let somebody in and they fuck up like this, it's like, wow, when is that ever going to happen again?
I also just love this moment, because this is like, we've all had these conversations with my best friend. Like, when you want to be mad at them, but, like, they spitting straight facts, no chasing and shit, like, you just like, god damn, I'm going to eat this shit, because Molly had to eat all that shit. Like, it was real for Molly. Like, she had to take in, like, that she's been super negative. And then she actually hit her. She had a whole moment of clarity, like, damn, I have been on some negative shit.
Did she,
like,
though?
I don't know.
We've been here before.
She got a dose of the shit. She got a dose of the shit.
Listen, we've been here before when we thought Molly learned some shit.
God damn, you're right.
So, well, yeah, Molly's that example of that really smart dumb person,
right.
or that really dumb smart person, whichever way you want to say it. Like, she's so together in every other aspect, but because of that desperation to, like, find that partner that matches her, and the expectation that no person is her equal, she lets things get in her way. I mean, even first season, her and Issa were going to be on the outs because of just disagreeing.
Somebody on Twitter yesterday said Molly is Pam for Martin.
Oh my God.
I mean, less problematic. I mean, less problematic TV. But yeah, I get it. I can see the similarity.
So then, hold on, I lost where I was at. Oh, okay. So then they go to Molly's job, and Molly rolls up on Tori and was like, when do you want to get working on this case? And Tori was like, I'm not working on that case. You got it. And she was like, what? And then he was like, yeah, I'm taking this case, this other case. And then she walked in the room, and there was two black women that Molly, like, fucking pissed off a couple episodes back. And they was like, congratulations on that case, Molly. Yeah. It was so petty. Oh, that was good. I was like,
But you knew that was going to happen. I'm like, this is why you don't burn bridges, because I'm sorry, the bridges you burn, they can rebuild together.
I was like, listen, that was some good. That was
and that's
good.
Exactly what happened. It was like, oh, you knew it. All of a sudden, they cool with Tori. And it's like, because y'all all now have a common enemy.
Nah, see, first of all, no, you read that wrong. Tori knew what he was doing. Tori was like, well, I'm going to go help them. And I'm going to show this bitch why she shouldn't have crossed me again. Like, that's how she
but also really for her, but also it helps them too, because they know Torian is the partner's favorite. So why wouldn't you work with him? It's a win-win for both.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah. You're right.
So then Issa is meeting with Blair at his coffee shop, and she was like, thank you so much for helping me out. We got this, we got that. She was like, I really want this big celebrity here. And she was like, what you mean you really want? I know the A&R at Rock Nation, so I can get you a big headliner. And I was like, okay, she's talking all this big shit. What's going to happen here? And then she was like, I'm going to go on a date. I'm about to go on this date. And I was like, okay, look at her. Look at Blair. So then
I'm late for a date. Yeah, yeah.
So then they go by Issa's crib, and Nathan left some flowers there. Then they go to Andrew, and I said his hair was flowing like an Asian god.
Like, I mean, I just cannot get over that. Like, that is not my type at all, but that shit had me stop for a second.
Let me tell you something. Charmaine, I follow him on Instagram. So I've seen the hair down. Yes.
That's not normally my thing. But as soon as I saw that hair, I was like, I didn't know I liked long hair before. Oh my God.
He has pictures of himself with his hair down. And then people were like, when you gonna ever wear your hair down? When are you ever gonna wear your hair down on the show? And he was like, I mean, oh no. And then here come this episode. I'm like,
listen, that wasn't just his hair down. That hair was fucking styled. That hair was clearly just freshly shampooed. Smooth. Yo,
when I seen the nigga though, I thought of the nigga from Earth, Wind & Fire, the old nigga. that shit was late. That nigga was out here.
That shit was late. I said, okay. Next thing
it
I know.
It wasn't just the hair, though. It was the look on his face. There's that thing it's a weird kind of hotness that men and women can do when they are just, they're not here for it.
The unbothered.
And they make that face. I don't know. There's a whole package thing going on there. There was the face and that luxurious hair.
I said a couple weeks ago, Andrew smooth as shit. When he went on a date with Molly, he was super smooth. I was like, look at this dude. He's smooth. I'm sure. That nigga got it. So, and then Andrew was like, what do you want, bitch? That's basically what he said.
Pretty much. Words.
And she was like, I just want to come and apologize.
Molly do better.
And he
Molly
was like,
better.
I ain't really got time for this. And she was like, okay, I've come to the conclusion that I don't always assume the best in the people, and I've been really selfish, and that my last relationship hurt me, and I was taking it out on people like you, and I just want to say I'm sorry. And then Andrew was like, I'm still here. So do you think that was him forgiving her and, like, that he going to give it a shot? Or do you think he was just like, you done?
Oh, you got to know. We saw the foreshadowing. Like, you know, because, like.
I see the window. Because, one,
he didn't get off the phone.
He could have just said okay and hung up.
He could have not took her call at all. I mean, let's be honest. He didn't have to answer the phone. He could have left that nigga
Nathan
walked
in the house and shit, though.
That shit was funny.
Yeah, like, Nathan just walked in the house in the background.
And it was just like, what the hell? Oh, he really does live there, doesn't he?
You know what? Because I didn't know. Thought he got his barbershop together, you know what I mean?
So then they launched at the bar, and look who fucking shows up at the bar. Fucking Blair. And she said this was their second date.
Yeah.
Because she was like, I'm late this time.
Right.
So this is the second date? Okay. And she was like, I thought you scared you away when I was talking about the divorce. So then I wrote, hold up. This is not the same woman from the church, is it?
No. He was talking to his dad about the women he was dating. Like, you know, they had baggage. Like, some of them divorced. Some of them were crazy.
So we're just talking about this date that we didn't see.
Yeah, it was a foreshadowing. I was like, who is this chick? And this is the chick from one of the ladies from the baby shower, the girl that he was talking to there.
Stephanie, look at you. You put it together, girl.
They were talking to her in the photos.
When Issa said, we met at the baby shower. I'm like, the baby shower. And then when she met Marsh, I'm like, oh, that girl he was talking to when they was looking at the portrait.
Look at you.
Her hair was stacked a lot differently. So
exactly. Yeah, that's what throws you off. You're like, oh, we all black. We wear our hair different.
She got that Vanessa Bell Calloway shit from coming to America and shit.
You know what? It threw me off at first because I didn't put two and two together. Because when she said I had a date, I'm like, it better not be Nathan. That was my first thought. I'm like, it better not be Nathan.
It did look a little shady, like she was hiding information by saying the way she said she had a date.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you think she knows that Lawrence and Issa used to date?
I don't think she do. Not a second date.
That's the part I'm trying to figure out. Because if she knows Tiffany. Oh. And she saw them at
the... Tiffany is running her mouth about Dro and What's-Her-Face having a baby.
Yeah.
And Candace. Now, she didn't run her mouth about it. She just knew the company to tell that to.
Shit all the time, telling other people shit. All the time.
She just here for the action, yo. She here for the drama, yo.
So,
I love it.
That's another good cliffhanger. And so then you finally get the Nathan and Issa reunion. So I'm going to play this a little bit too.
Thanks for meeting. Thanks for meeting me. I hope you like the flowers. Look, I didn't mean to take off like that. You didn't deserve it. I was in my head because I went back to Houston for a bit. I was just dealing with a lot of shit. And, you know, I don't know how to explain it, but sometimes I get like really down and kind of negative. And I just can't talk to people sometimes. And I didn't want to put you through that.
So you ghosted me and left LA because you were in a bad mood?
I know that's fucked up. It's, I just wasn't thinking straight. And I wish I had, like, a better explanation, but that's the truth.
Nathan, I didn't ask for you to come into my life. You came after me and then you just left. Like it was nothing.
Look, I'm sorry.
So, what's going on here, Steph?
Oh my God. Okay.
The woman perspective, please.
Let me say this. So I'm gonna try to not get emotional about this because I am triggered. And so as somebody who has depression, I understood exactly what he was saying because here's the thing about depression. You don't ever want to put your shit on somebody else. Mm-hmm. And so you just disappear. And it's not to hurt the person. It's not because you fucking hate people. It's just, I am so dark right now. I don't want you around that. And so in that moment, I realized that Nathan really does care about her. Because when you really care about somebody, you don't want to be around them. You're just like, I just don't want your I don't want you to see me like this. I don't want you to be around this because it's horrible for me. So the thing about this, I don't even know if he actually went all the way back to Houston. He could have. And mind you, this is post-Harvey Houston. Why would anybody just voluntarily go back? That's because you just don't want to be around anybody. You just don't want to be anybody around it. So I know there were some folks saying like Issa was kind of flipping about it. But if you have never dealt with anybody with depression, you don't know what to say.
Yeah. And, he just and said, usually they down. Do say things like that to us. Like they do say things like, oh, you're not feeling, you're not happy. You're not, you know, you're having a bad day.
You're having a bad day.
It's grow like up, you know. Sad.
I'm like, that's not what's going
it's
on.
It's not
here.
What this is. Yeah.
It's not.
Yeah.
It's like, oh,
so do you, yeah. think, do you
it think it was too real? And I'm like, Regina directed the fuck out of this episode.
Yes, she did.
Yeah.
Thank you. Go, Regina Hall.
Ooh, this is so real. King. And the fact that Issa
King, my bad. No, I'm sorry. Yeah.
So do you think if Nathan and Issa are really trying to be together, that he, because I don't understand, I'm not familiar with this. Do you think he should have explained it better? Or do you understand how he was explaining it?
It's not going to take a couple minutes. It's not. Yeah. So this is a long conversation. It really is. I feel like he should have wrote something down.
And like, there's no right way. Yeah, I mean, there's no right.
So if he'd have left a letter in her mailbox, you think that would have been better?
No, I mean, like,
reading
it to her.
Right.
So that is something that I do with my husband, because even though he's been with me for all these years, he still doesn't quite know how to maneuver my depression very well or how to deal with me when I'm in those patches. And so there's times when I'll write things down just to get through the discussions that are sometimes also fights, because you're trying to explain, like, you have to, the person who doesn't have depression has to get out of their own head about how they are, and they have to stop viewing depression as sadness, because the thing is with depression, you are always depressed, whether or not you are happy or sad.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can still be happy or sad, but you are always depressed, because depression is something that happens, it's a chemical thing that's happening in your brain. Correct. And depending on what part of your brain it's happening in is what's going on, you know, what's going on with you. So like, this is a multi-stage thing. This is the first explanation, and then if she's willing to talk to him again, it's going to be on him to say, like, look, this shit's going to happen, and you know, if you do decide to be in a relationship with me, these are some of the things that are going to happen. But you also got to allow that person space to walk away and be like, this is not for me. You know, that other partner has to be able to say, like, I understand you got this going on, but it's not for me. And I don't want to take on that burden. And both parties have to be ready for that. So I agree. Like, this scene was really real for me, too. Yeah. And I was hurt by the flippancy of Issa, but at the same time, I've heard that same thing so many times. I know people who don't suffer from depression don't, that's how they talk
they
to
you. They don't get it. Right, right.
They don't get it. And it's
you can see the pain on his face. And
that guy's a good actor right there. That was real.
He was really good. And now, because remember, he packed up and left Houston and moved to California. Now, if you really think about it, that's like taking two steps backwards, because you're moving from Houston to a place that's, you know what, three times more expensive.
And how the people have mental health issues.
And it was just like, why would you move to California from Houston to California? And it's just like, wait a minute. And like, that actually just makes sense, because sometimes you make decisions that don't actually make sense.
True. Yeah.
Yeah, but
because
this
you think about it, you're like, why would you just leave? And then he disappeared for a month and went back. It's like, wait, what?
So I wrote on Twitter, this is one of them things that Issa does not need to go to her girls about. Because Molly and I don't think Molly and Kelly can handle this responsibly.
Right. They're not evolved to talking that.
They couldn't even handle sexual fluidity, so they definitely not handle it.
Right? Yeah, they're not. Like, plus the other part is depression is your own thing. And if you choose to partner with someone who does suffer from depression, their depression is theirs. It is not your job to be talking about their depression.
Correct.
Unless you, So it's better for, like, I hate to say it this way, but it's better for the person who is partnering a person of depression to have a person like a therapist to talk to about their partner's depression and not their friends, because by exposing it to their friends, they're exposing that partner to, you know, people's opinions and feelings that they don't need to tack on to their depression.
Right. You know? Right. And can we add on the part of the fact that this is a man dealing with depression and how...
Right. It's a black man dealing with depression.
Exactly. I love the way that this arc is going to show up in season four, because one, I think the way he described it, stereotype it.
Right.
Like this, like, men aren't going to say, I'm depressed, unless you're like you're very, very enlightened. It's like, you can tell. I'm like, guys don't really talk about, hey, I have depression and I have to deal with this, and this is every day, and I have good days and bad days. Guys don't talk like that. Yeah. So this is going to be the other part of that.
Right. And that's what I was going to hit on, as far as like when you're dealing with depression and when you're speaking to somebody that really doesn't know how to handle being with somebody that has mental health issues, the shame you feel from other people it increases your depression about even wanting to open up about your depression, right? Because it's a cross you bear alone, and people don't understand that. When I was dealing with my depression, people would like, you're not depressed.
You're just sad. You're just having a bad day. That's not what's going on.
Right. Yeah. You can't. And it makes you feel like, who can I go to that will understand it? And just respect my mental state. It's a very real thing. So for us to even, like you said, the black man arc of this is amazing. And to get more black people talking about it, because black people watch the show, is great, because, you know, there's black people out here that really can't even talk about being, you know, gay to their families, or even, how they live their lives. So, like, just by getting, you know, all our insecurities out there on screen, that can begin to start conversations and dialogue in that way, I think is amazing. So, I do kudos to Regina King for directing this so great.
So good. It's like, wow.
Yeah. I mean, this moment is the thing that kind of won me back, in terms of, like I said earlier, the season was kind of dipping for me, and I was kind of losing interest. And then this brought it back to be like, you know what? They're showing whole ass black people, like, no matter how flawed or problematic, like, we're seeing all sides. And I've said it on my shows before too, because we talk about depression a lot, is that, you know, in our community, again, with another generalization, we don't have depression. You just, something's off, right? You either need Jesus, or you need a salad, or you need to go for a walk. There's no such thing as depression in our community.
Exactly.
And to get this opportunity to see, well, hopefully we'll get to see this play out in the future seasons. And more than that, also teaching people how to respond to people of depression is what I hope that they take care of, I guess, in their next version of this, to show us how it is. Like, you're going to fuck up, you're going to say the wrong things to a person of depression, and then you're going to fix it, you're going to learn, and you're going to fix it. And I want to see Issa go down that journey, if she's willing to. Like, obviously I don't think people should have to stay just because they discover a person has depression, but if they are willing to stay, and like in my case, I've been lucky enough to have a partner that has stuck through it, even as he doesn't get it a lot of the times, you know, being there and learning how to talk to us is a big step. And I really hope we get to see that. And I love that we get to see that with black people, because we don't get it enough.
No, we don't. It's go to church. God will remove
pray that shit away, and not saying that prayer doesn't work or prayer doesn't change things. However, God puts people on this earth to help you.
Right.
Stop running away from, and I think that's always been our detriment, where we're just like, we have all these tools. It's like, use them. He puts people in your life for a reason. Other people, like, I have, like, I'm a Christian and I have Christian friends. I have Christian friends that are therapists. I have Christian friends that are in therapy.
Right.
It's a wonderful tool if you allow it to be.
Also, stigmas are weird. Like,
super.
Yeah. Why do we decide that these certain things deserve to be stigma? You know, why can't we be fluid sexually? Why can't we be fluid mental health wise? You know, why? Like, because I've suffered from chronic persistent depression from as young as I can remember. Not diagnosed until I was an adult, but I could definitely call back to my childhood and show those same sides. I've had multiple bouts of major depression throughout my life, and then I kind of come out of it, but I'm never not, it's never not there, you know, it's never not in the background somewhere. Can I be happy? Yeah. Like one day I was a super dark day for me and I didn't come home. I went to a hotel. I called my husband from a hotel and said, I'm not coming home today because I got to deal with this. And then the next day we went to a concert and had the fucking time of our life, you know? So like depression is weird. You compartmentalize, you segment, you do weird stuff. Sometimes you go back to a place that's not healthy, like probably was the case for the Nathan character, go back to a place that's not healthy because you're like, maybe this is what I deserve. A lot of times you get that in depression where you feel like if I'm not getting better, maybe I deserve to just go all in on the darkness. And it seems to be what they're trying to say with that character, that he went back to the place that was probably pretty dark for him.
Right. And the sharpness of from him and Issa just kind of chilling out and like connecting to him just ghosting. Yeah, that really does signal depression. Because that's how sharp it can go. It's like you could be happy one minute and the next minute you could just be like tears welling up in your eyes.
I think the sensationalist nature of everyone, a lot of people watching the show wanted it to be something else. But if you think about it,
yeah, because like Brandon was putting him in jail. He's like, that nigga in jail.
Yeah, but I said it last week. I was like, it's probably going to be some type of mental health issue. And that's kind of how they're going to handle it on the show. And that's kind of what it was. And I thought he did a great job. Because, like, if you were just to look at that in a vacuum, you would be like, this nigga can't act. Why is he talking like this and making those faces? But. Mm-hmm. When you look at it in the context of what they're trying to get across, it makes perfect sense why he's talking like that and making those faces. So I thought that was really, really well done. And then right after that, Issa walks in her house and she started looking around. And I said, this nigga ain't unpack her shit yet. She's been there at least 2 months.
Boy, that apartment is looking actually nicer than it used to.
That's it. She still had plastic on the damn couch.
But she had.
She didn't have a couch though.
She didn't have a couch. I mean, is her apartment looking nicer? Like,
So we bit by bit, she's able to afford to get her shit together, I guess, and pick up new stuff.
And then she did.
It's funny that they end this season with a couch. Like, even though it wasn't on the forefront or whatever, that a couch was a part of it, because that's how we end, you know, the first season, the significance of the couch symbolizing the end of that relationship and stuff like that, and this is like her new beginning couch. Like, I don't know. I'm a film person, so I'm thinking in terms of like what was the writer thinking, and that was probably has a lot to do with.
And then they did that thing that all of us do, is you put on some house clothes, put on some music, and then just start cleaning and shit.
Yeah, sure.
And you just be in the zone, just cleaning with the music bumping or fixing stuff up, or like when you're moving in some shit. And I was like, that's real relatable. But then, so they clearly showed that couch is facing the hallway. And then it looked like she's watching TV. But I'm like, it's no TV there. So what's she looking at? So I was mad confused there. But I was just joking about that. And then they kind of end the season with like this idea that like it's a new Issa again. So we've had new Issa before, but I think Issa has grown a lot this season. Like, this is the growth year for Issa. She wasn't so childish the entire season, except a couple times this season.
Harry the Spy, you know, definitely.
Yeah. Go ahead.
That wasn't far enough in the season, far enough back in the season for her not to still be risky.
Right.
So before we get out of here, let's just, we'll go around with the two things. What'd you think about the season overall? And then what are you looking forward to in season 4? We'll start with you, Charmaine.
I think because of the last episode, I need to give the rest of the season a watch again and like view it through a different lens, because I was kind of getting disappointed in the direction. I was feeling like there wasn't enough growth, I guess, for the Issa character. And I was thinking, like, how long can you drag out this, you know, childish grown woman thing going on? So I feel like I need to kind of review it, because this last episode does make me reassess kind of what I was thinking about everything that was going on. But the thing, like, more than anything, I just love how many different types of Black people there are on the show. I don't [S2] Yes. [S1] Know a better way of saying it. Just like, you know, we're messy. We're not we got our shit together. Sometimes we're arrogant. Sometimes we're insecure. Sometimes we're, you know, depressed. Sometimes we're kind of a little bit crazy, you know, like it doesn't feel like archetypes. It feels just like regular ass people. And
it's
that's
people we know. Yeah, definitely.
People it's people, know you know, right? Like, right. Like mm-hmm. Kelly, I feel like there's several friends in my past that I can go back to and think of as sort of the Kelly of my friendship. That I think I've been the Molly sometimes, and I think, you know, I've had the Molly friend, you know, like everybody has a thing, and I really like it. I'm glad to see that it's kept going. I love how I just love how pro Black. Like, I know I'm mixed, but I always have a pro Black bend to my way. So, like, I just love seeing all those kinds of Black people. I love that colorism isn't a thing on this show in the way that they have been on other shows. Like, you know, yeah, they mention light skinness and all this other kind of stuff.
Light skin love.
Yeah. You know, but it's not always like only the light skinned people on the show are the ones that are attractive, and the dark skinned ones are kind of bypassed. Like, you get a full picture of Black beauty on this show, male and female. Amen. And it's like everything about this, that kind of stuff makes me happy. The fact that they finally figured out how to fucking light Black people. I mean, again, my film stuff, you know, all this kind of stuff makes me happy about this show that they do right. So
they
yeah,
definitely light Black people really good.
Yeah, they do. They figured it out on this show. And so, yeah, I just think I need to be a little bit more charitable with the rewatch of this season than I was going into this last episode. But this last episode kind of filled in a lot of gaps for me that I kind of needed to stay on.
We're glad you're back.
And they also they also don't do it like Tyler Perry, where, like, all the light-skinned women are evil and shit.
Yeah, that is a funny
thing. No, the dark-skinned men are terrible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No, you got to reveal that they're terrible. Like, you know what I mean? But, like, oh,
well,
man.
Well, Shamar Moore wasn't terrible. He just had terrible hair.
Oh, man. Yeah.
So, and what are you looking forward to next season?
I want to see this Nathan thing play out. I would love to see a show dedicated to maneuvering depression in a relationship and stuff like that. I think that would be good. I think Molly needs a win, if anything, just to calm her the fuck down.
Yes.
And
because think about how problematic she was. Not problematic when she was getting dicked down by Dro. She wasn't even around. She was happy.
She was happy. Yeah.
Oh, she was still problematic.
Like, if we can figure out the Dro thing, I wasn't mad at the Dro relationship. Not just from the Polly perspective, but because I felt like she was kind of her best self during parts of that. She was still independent and had her stuff going. But, you know, she had this relationship that was also making her happy. So if she could figure that out, if we can learn what is going on with them better, that would be fun for the next season. But yeah, I think that's about it. I just keep, if they just keep showing the intersectionality of Blackness, that makes me happy.
Excellent. Steph, same question for you. What do you think about this season overall, and what are you thinking about? What are you looking forward to next season?
I honestly love the growth of all the characters. I mean, Kelly didn't have to grow nowhere. She stayed the same, so she's been the same since day one, and I love her since day one. But to see the growth of mostly Issa, I really enjoyed it. I really enjoyed the different arcs that they took on, because I think when it, you know, the show got hammered last year because of the quote unquote not use of condoms, where it's like, y'all don't do this with other shows. I'm like, y'all didn't do this with Sex in the City. Y'all didn't do this with any of the other shows. But because it was our show, it's like, oh, what about the condoms? Y'all need to be responsible. Oh, shut up. Y'all are not always responsible. Shut up. oh God. But I love seeing the growth. I love seeing the different elements that they brought to the show that we know about, but we don't ever want to talk about. We don't ever want to talk about Polly. We don't ever want to talk about depression. We don't ever want to talk about toxic masculinity, because it was a lot of that this season. And I like the way that it was discussed. I mean, of course, we're not going to solve it in like 8 episodes, but, or 10 episodes. 10? 8?
8.
8, okay.
I think it's 8, yeah.
Yeah, I was like, I had to think. 10, 8, 2. I mean, I feel like, like, I don't know. But, of course, we're not going to solve it. But to actually have those conversations, I really enjoyed the... I'm glad they grew up a little bit on this season, especially Issa. Because in the first couple of seasons, when we saw like her whole dynamic with Lawrence, you thought that Issa had her shit together and she don't.
Yeah.
And it's like, it was refreshing. I'm like, that's real, because everybody thinks you get to a certain age. I'm like, of course you got your shit together. He was the one on the couch. I'm like, yeah, he was on the couch for 3 years that we didn't see.
Yeah.
It's like,
that lens, a different perspective, yeah.
Like, he was on the couch for 3 years. It's like, he's the one, she's the one together because she's the one with the job. That don't mean she got her shit together.
Yeah.
Devin, what about you?
I'm going to take a different approach. I love this, the show in general, because like Charmaine said, we see the intersection of so many Black people that we know, and we see ourselves in this show, like not just from where we are in our lives or what we're going through, but stuff that we can relate to. We see it in our families, and we can have these conversations, and we need a show like this. I love being able to see more of Lauren's stories, and we have more character development of non-main characters this year, and which was great. I wish Molly would just stop being so problematic, but she was gorgeous this year. The beauty we saw on this year was great. Everybody stepping their game up as far as evolving in some way or trying to fix what their insecurity was. I think I'm looking forward to finding out more about Dro and Candace's Polly situation, if Molly and Andrew will or won't be, the development of Issa and Lawrence's friendship, and does Blair come into it? And hopefully Molly can get out of her own way with her prejudging, because she does prejudge a lot of people and project a lot of situations. More Kelly. I'm just happy Issa got her shit together and took baby steps to get better as a person. And we'll see where her and Nathan go. And I'm maybe... mental health is something we touch on next year, which I hope we do, because we need that representation on TV as far as black people dealing with mental health issues. But that's it.
I like how they started things and got rid of things and didn't let it linger. Like, Daniel's gone, like that nigga gone, but he'll probably be back at some point, but they didn't like keep bringing that thing up. I like how Issa grew as a character. I like how they more aligned you with how Molly operates and why she does the stupid stuff that she does sometimes. And I like how they ended the season with a lot of cliffhangers, a lot of questions. What's up with Blair and Lawrence? Like, what's going to go on with Molly at her job? How's Nathan dealing with the depression? Is Issa going to take Nathan back? Like, there's a lot of different things that's going on here that have a lot of questions that can be answered next year, which I'm really, really, really excited about, and they already got approved. And a lot of that Black love, you get to see a lot of different Black people are always like, we're not a monolith, but, you know, you don't get to see that on media that often. And this is a show that basically gives you all the different types of Black people, from different age gaps to different wage gaps, to different like lifestyles, different sexualities, and all that stuff, sexual preferences, mental illness, mental health issues, like those. Seeing all those different things in one show is really, really cool to see. So, I still love the show, even though I have issues with it sometimes. It's one of those things where it's still something that I can't wait to watch every week. So that's
every week. Yeah.
Before we get out of here, Charmaine, tell everybody about your show and what you got coming up this week.
I got two shows, actually, Militantly Mixed and Militantly Mixed, the Black as Fuck edition. On Tuesdays, the Black as Fuck edition is me and my boy Blurred Vision from childhood. We're both mixed black and we grew up together. We grew up mixed together and stuff like that. So we just talk about blackness from the mixed black perspective. Okay. This coming week, we're talking about Botham Jean and criminalizing victims and victimizing criminals. So that's the, and we ended up going into the Kavanaugh stuff on there too, just because the, that kind of topic was going that way. And then we, this week on Militantly Mixed, which drops on Thursday, I am sharing my DNA journey through finding out where from Africa my family was stolen from. That was a big deal for me to finally be able to have that bridge to Africa. I've never felt comfortable calling myself African American. I've always been black, and this gives me just one step back. So now, you know, I have an opportunity. If I ever have an opportunity to pilgrimage back, I'll at least have a place to go. That'll be home, you know. So I share that this week on Militantly Mixed, and so we're just trying to live our mixed ass lives on Militantly Mixed.
Shout out to the mixture.
Dope.
That's super dope, though.
Steph, what do you got going on the Mocha Minutes podcast? Your week after your anniversary show?
Yes. So thank you. So this week I am joined by James. Well, I have my first international guest. So I have James Roberts. He does the Game Set Mind podcast. Yes, connects. Hey, group.
I think he's Japanese and black too.
I think he is.
Yeah.
So it's like, look at that, man. Listen, I'm
black
excited.
Black and knees in the house.
Black and knees.
And his father is actually American, and I think his mother is British because he lives in Wales. So he's also a 2-time Paralympian. He is currently he is a online personal trainer, and he also plays wheelchair basketball. So we really just really talked about him. We talked a little bit about sports, but it mostly was just talking to him, like kind of learning about him. So that will be out tomorrow.
Wow, look forward to it.
Excellent. What do we got? So we're going to be reviewing for some reason.
God damn you, Brandon. God damn it.
Spider-Man 3.
What happened?
I'm telling you is I had to watch this shit because of this man. And I realized, how is Kirsten Dunst a thing? How?
Oh, yeah, she's terrible.
Can I just tell you, I hate the first Spider-Man. I hate it.
I hate it.
I like the second one. I don't know why, but like, the second one I liked, but the first one, ugh, garbage. The third one, ugh, garbage. I'm like, ugh, God. Why was this a thing? Why can't they get Spider-Man right?
And they were selling, yo. That fucking, they was doing numbers too,
yo. He was 30 years old trying to be a high school Peter Parker.
I like the Andrew Garfield one better because at least he was a little bit younger, but still,
Andrew Garfield was still old. He just looked.
He looked younger.
Tom's my favorite.
Tom is, he is Spider-Man.
It feels like Spider-Man.
It took y'all like 6 different times. It's kind of like the Hulk. I'm like, sheesh.
So the movie's on Netflix if you guys want to watch along with us. So we'll be reviewing that revisiting that either tomorrow or Wednesday because Venom comes out on Thursday. So
oh my god, my ticket's
already.
Are you excited about it? Hold on.
Yeah. No.
Do tell something. Why are you excited about this?
Well, I'm excited because I like Tom.
I love Tom Hardy.
So like, hot. Like, oh my god.
So this is probably not the nicest thing to say, but even though I'm married to a half a big, I don't particularly find white boys attractive, but there's something about Tom I like.
He got it. He got charisma.
There's something about him. Like he's
swag,
like,
honey.
He's like that sweet, but willing to do dirt if he's got to. I don't know what it is about him, but there's something that appeals to him. And my dad's side, my other side of the family is British too. So I feel a thing about him. I don't know. So yes. I'm happy about him. I think the trailer looks like a hot mess, and I hope they don't destroy it. But I'm a big comic book girl and stuff like that. Venom and Spider-Man were never really high on my list of characters that I enjoy, but I like the new Spider-Man, and I like Tom Hardy, so I'm just hoping that if they get it together right and they eventually merge the two films, that it might be interesting. I'm just excited about it
because of Tom. Huh? Yeah, you do, because they never going to get merged with Spider-Man.
Well, yeah, no, they've said not that. Not but version, also, you know, they have the merger, the recent merger of Fox into, or I guess it's not fully completed yet, but they have the merger from Fox into Disney, with Disney finally having control of the entire Marvel universe. We still have these options. It's stupid for them to make declarations like, and this is probably a topic for another show, but like, it's stupid for them to make declarations that they'll never merge these characters or these universes, because we're fucking out here. Comic book fans have proven that we are no longer here for the big dramatic movies. We're here for the big fucking comic book movies. See what we did with Black Panther. You see what we did with Avengers. So like, if you're going to tell me you're never going to give me a proper X-Men crossover character with Avengers, then you're stupid. If you're going to tell me you're never going to meet a good Venom, if he ends up being a good Venom, we don't know yet, October 5th. With the current good Spider-Man. And like, this Spider-Man has got me actually paying attention to Spider-Man, and I didn't used to. So like, if they can merge these two things, there's just money in it for us. Like, comic book fans are crazy out here. And like, I'm a 40-year-old woman, and I'm still hardcore nostalgic for my childhood books, and I still continue to read books to this day. So if they can merge those two, I would be really excited about it.
You're gonna come on that regular show pretty soon.
Yeah. I'll do it. You tell me when, I'll do it. That's
all we talk about is comic books and TVs and all that shit.
But Steph, are you going Black Lightning with us this year? I feel like
yes, you know I am.
Okay, I just got it.
Favorite thirst trap is on there. I love her.
What's your favorite thirst trap?
Professor Williams.
Oh, you're talking about Anissa? Oh, yeah. Anissa is so fine, but she is a horrible actress.
Scotty bags.
But on Instagram, she is a whole thirst trap and a half, and yes, I love it.
I love it too.
Love it so much. I'm like, girl,
except
I love
on the show, she kept talking about how fat her ass was, and we keep watching the show,
and we don't see it. She got cupcakes,
but on IG, I feel like her butt like grew like three times the size. I'm like, well, damn, girl.
her dramatic ass.
Watched that one yet?
Oh, you ever watched Black Lightning?
I'm a Marvel girl who loves Batman too, so I got to work my way over.
Did you watch The Gifted?
No, I haven't yet.
Oh, The Gifted!
Oh my god!
I haven't watched that
either, and I need to.
Oh, it's so good. Season two came out with a bang. We're supposed to be reviewing that too. That's another thing. We're doing The Gifted. So the shows that we're doing this year are The Gifted. I mean, this fall, we're doing The Gifted. We're doing Black Lightning. And I haven't decided. We do three shows, and I haven't decided on the third show.
I think we should do Supergirl.
Devin and Mike don't want to do The Flash, although I still enjoy The Flash.
I tried to watch it. I couldn't get past, like, I think the second episode.
Oh, okay.
Oh, see, season one was good. It's that.
That was the problem, is that everybody told me it was good, and I only got to the second episode, and I couldn't keep going. So I either got to push through until it gets good, or I don't know if it's for me, but... Again, I'm a Marvel girl. I just happen to be. Oh, you're like
The Gifted. Gifted is about the X-Men.
Well, do you watch? Have you seen The Runaways?
I have it queued up. I was waiting for the season to be over, and then I just haven't caught up yet. So, because I want to burn through them, I don't want to have to sit there and wait.
They're 45 minutes, so it's not easy to burn through. It really isn't, but it's good. It's really.
Oh, you don't know me, sir.
I can binge. That's a talent, yo. It's hard to binge, yo.
So we may take.
I love it. That's the way I watch TV.
Charmaine, do you watch American Horror Story?
I did up through. So I haven't seen what's the current season is the one with the creepy baby on the poster. I haven't seen that one yet. And I didn't see last season, but
Roanoke and Apocalypse. Okay.
Yeah, I haven't seen.
You missed that from Roanoke.
But I really like the Coven was my favorite.
Ooh, that was good.
I liked Murder House a lot.
Murder House is just legend.
It was really super creepy. I dig
it. Yeah, I think the show's good. It started to lose me during the carnival one called the freak show. Yeah, they lost me on that one. I'm gonna skip the rest of that. Like, I only watched halfway through it, and
I didn't watch all of Asylum. I'm the same.
Asylum is good. Asylum, I got scared.
It didn't keep my attention. I was like, no, bleh.
And then Coven came back.
You gotta wait. It gets good towards the end. Like it starts to get real good towards the end.
That's what I keep hearing.
Yeah.
So we may be skipping our regular show this week and just knocking these reviews out to catch up. Because we're also going to see Venom this week, and so we'll have to review that. So we got a lot of stuff coming out this week. But we will be back next year for Insecure. And like I said, we'll be reviewing those things. So thank you, Steph. Thank you, Charmaine. Thank you, Danielle. She'll be back for Black Lightning.
Yes.
Thank you, Lauren from the Two Woke Girls podcast. Thanks for Rashani from the Single Simulcast. You guys made this Insecure review so much fun.
Don't forget Rashani's co-host.
Oh, and Shantae.
Yes. Shantae.
I was just on that show the other day too.
Dope. Look at that Cali love. That Cali podcasting.
Actually, surprise ending. Rashani and I went to high school together, but we didn't know each other.
What?
We found out by accident.
That is crazy.
Yeah.
That is crazy.
So dope.
That is a small world.
We out here. Black podcasting. We out here.
Yes.
So thank you, everyone, for listening, and we'll be back soon, and we'll finish Insecure with some more Cardi B. No makeup, got collard greens, cornbread, neck bone, back fat. Get it from my mama, and you don't know where your daddy at. Knick knack, daddy whack, give a dog a bone. Put it on him, but your nigga never coming home. I'm a flex like a boy, I'm a 10, she a joy. Stupid hoe, unimportant, unattractive, unemployed. Get some guap guap, get some chicken guap guap, get some bread guap guap, get some chicken guap.